Is this working? Good morning. I'm waiting for our projectionist to give me the thumbs up, so. Okay, just gave me the thumbs up, so we can go now. Okay, well, welcome to the Roy Branson Legacy Sunday School. This is our Christmas season. We want to welcome our visitors to sunny, warm Southern California. My friend Carney Dumitri and his wife are going to go back to Maryland next week, so where it's warm. But he's Canadian, so I guess he's used to these things. Let me see. A few things. I wanted to make an announcement about offerings. David mentioned in his announcement, you can make a gift to the Roy Branson Legacy Sabbath School class. We still haven't got it worked out where you can give gifts online, but we think we're going to get that worked out right after the first of the year. Kim Rawson, our new treasurer, was not sure how to get that all taken care of, so we're going to put him on a learning curve. But you can make a gift to the Roy Branson class. Make sure you put it. What? Oh, Forrest Howe. make the church the recipient of your check. But if you put it here, it'll come to the Roy Branson class. Thank you, Branson. Okay. And we have quite a few things that we want to do. We're getting quite an attendance. We're up into 20s and 30s now. So we got quite a few. David said that he's getting responses throughout at least California and some through the United States. So anyway, on New Year's Eve, the Brandstetters, I like this, Bernard and Beverly Brandstetter. We're going to have a New Year's Eve party. This is here. Take a look at that. We are going to make an announcement about the parking there. It's Dr. Brandstetter mentioned we had to park correctly or we're going to hinder the flow of traffic. This week and next week, Dr. Tonstad will be speaking to us on the Book of Job. And I understand you're going to be going back to Norway pretty soon, is that? And this is your last hurrah here? Or at least for now, anyway, yeah. He wants to go back where it's warm, too, so. He's going to be speaking on the Book of Job. After the first year, Michael Schofield will be speaking on January 7th and January 14th. Okay, I'm going to rush right into having Dr. Tonstad come up here. He's going to talk about his book, God of Sense and Traditions of Nonsense. And everybody knows him, so I'm not going to announce who he is. But if you buy lots of these books, then he can leave the medical practice and teach for them. So, okay, should we just bow our heads? Father, we thank you again for this Christmas season, and we ask that you be with us in a special way, be with those who are traveling, be with Dr. Tonstad as he presents to us the Book of Job. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Okay.
So, thank you, and so I have thought of two topics. This time, the topic for today will be Does Unselfishness Exist? That's the title I have for the subject. And then next time, I'd like to talk on unheard illumination from the voice of the whirlwind. And that's not to say that people haven't heard it, but the part that I wish to emphasize is something that you haven't heard, even if you have heard it. So I just wish to highlight something there. I'm happy to have my wife here today, Selena. She is here and has been here for some weeks. We're here for a little longer than we had expected because we were supposed to have returned to Norway soon. And I'm very happy to have my daughter Crystal here, who came here last night from Cairo. And that's just wonderful. And I see some friends here, Michael and his wife. That's nice to see you and you. And so let's see. During the sermon today, Randy Roberts said that some of you, some of us may be running to Target this afternoon to do last minute Christmas shopping, so I thought, well, let me spare you that. You know, let me do you a favor. So I brought some books here, Common Sense and Traditions of Nonsense. You can send $30 to Santa Claus, and that takes care of that book. And then I brought some copies of my commentary on Romans, which I plan to say something about for this topic today. And for that, Santa Claus wants $40. So these are here, and if that appeals to you, please help yourself. And there is an envelope inside the books for that purpose. One person came to my house and got 13 books of this one to give to her loved ones for Christmas. I thought that was very, very, what should I say, affirming. That was nice. I liked it. These books do not make me rich, so don't think that there is any money in it for me. Absolutely nothing. Just breaking even is my goal, and I can't even do that. Okay. So I wonder if I could ask Michael, would you be willing to help me here? You know, it's unfair of you, unfair to do that to you out of town and all, but please, if you would, come down here. And Jeff, could you come? And then we need a microphone. And we need a narrator too. Roger, can you be the narrator? Yes, you need to come up here too. So you will have to pass the microphone between you. You know, so come in into the center here. So Roger is he has the narrator's role. And Michael, you are God. And Jeff, I'm sorry, but you are Satan.
Well cast.
And we're going to do this twice. The first time around, we're going to do it. God and Satan are going to talk as though they are essentially on the same team. You are working for him. You know, you're just doing your job, but you're doing it for him. That's the first time around. The second time around, you are not working for him. You're working for yourself. Against him. So because the paradigm of reading the book of Job depends quite a lot on this. Many readers of this book, many experts, think that this is a time when Satan still is just showing up for work. He works for God. He is doing his God-appointed task of questioning God in some ways. But the questioning is benign. You know. So he's just, you know, doing it. This is his job. He's supposed to raise questions, you know, but he's doing it in a context that is essentially friendly to God. So we're doing this twice. First, and then if you you can say, we are working as choreographers here now, so you can have input. So I said we'll do it twice. We might do it 5 times or 10 times, who knows, you know, till we have it right. Did you get the idea? First once, you know, friendly, and then the other way. So, and you pass the microphone between you, and then see what you can do here. And then we will have some questions.
One day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan,
"Where have you come from?"
"From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it."
"Yeah, have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil."
Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a fence around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands. and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand now and touch all that he has. He will curse you to your face. Yeah, very well. All that he has is in your power. Only do not stretch your hand out against him.
So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord.
So that was, you know, that was the sort of friendly version. Now, maybe the other version is the same, you know, maybe one can't do much about this, you know. But assuming that the other version isn't the same, that now there is a, you know, now there is an adversarial relationship, and Satan is not working for God. He is working against God, big time. You know, and it's not raising questions that are within, you know, the sort of purview of the divine administration, as it were. Now let's see, what you do with that. So shall we do it again? Is there anything you wish to instruct our readers about? You find my instructions are okay? Okay, so let's do it again.
One day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan,
"Where have you come from?"
"From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it."
"Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil."
"Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a fence around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face."
"Very well. All that he has is in your power. Only do not stretch out your hand against him."
So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord.
Okay, very good. So does anyone want to speak to the issue of which of these versions should be preferred, you know, and were you even aware that there are two versions, two ways of reading this? One was where Satan is just showing up for work and raising questions, and you know, that's it. And the other one where there is an adversarial thing. Do you want to have an opinion, express yourself on that subject? So let's see if we can get the microphone. I think we're just going to have interact the whole time here. Why not?
I'll get a lot of exercise.
Yes, exactly. So let's see. Could you raise your hand again, please? And then let's.
I guess my interpretation of where the story starts actually has God bragging. So it has never really occurred to me whether the relationship between God and the devil was friendly or antagonistic, so much as sometimes it's not good to have somebody bragging about you. I mean, he's bragging about the fact, you know, "Look at my servant Job, the man's absolutely marvelous." And then you see what unravels from Job's perspective.
So is that to be taken as a comment that where you think that was not very nice of God to do that?
Correct.
You know, leave him alone, you know. Anonymity would be preferable. Okay. Anyone else want to comment here? Yes.
Just
speak loudly?
I suppose.
Is there an ambiguity in the narrator's first comment? Is there an ambiguity in the narrator's first comment? One day the heavenly beings came to the present to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came. Is he one of the heavenly beings and just mentioned especially because he's going to star in this dialogue, or is he not a heavenly being at this point?
Well, that question speaks very much to our issue here. You know, how should this be read? Is he one of the heavenly beings who is the, you know, or is the Satan also came a kind of, you know, giveaway?
Intruder.
Yes, that he also came, but he is not a regular anymore, as it were, you know, that sort of thing. I think that picks up on nuances in the text that you know, could sway us one way or another, yes. Anyone else? Yes.
I'm sorry, I don't see the...
John.
Satan came as an owner of the earth because Adam lost it, and came as a somebody which is in charge with the earth, with the rest of the heavenly beings. But in that time, God just told him, slap him right there on the spot. Did you see my servant Job? In other words, he is the representant of the earth.
Okay. All right. Anyone else here? So let me explain the options a little more fully and bring in what scholars are saying. They are saying that the notion of Satan as a fallen angel is a late notion, that it isn't early, it isn't original. So when you see the term Satan in Job, for example, it has the article ha-satan, or ha-shatan, or whichever, you know, the way you pronounce the S, the Satan, the adversary, you know. But he isn't, you know, the full-blown Satan of later sort of New Testament theology that is God's, you know, sworn enemy. So that's the position that many scholars say. Yes, there is an adversary here, but he isn't, you know, the full, you know, the bad, the really bad one. He is actually still playing a role on God's side, raising legitimate questions, and, you know, so it goes, you know. And there are very good scholars who think so because of this very entrenched assumption that the notion of dualism, good and evil, God and Satan, is a relatively late conception. Maybe it owes to Persian influences. When the Israelites went into exile, Persian influences, you know, the dualism, Zoroastrian influences, and you come back from exile and you have picked up theological ideas from abroad, you know, and you have now become, you know, have this idea of cosmic conflict theme. Now that's the scholarly view. Now before we, you know, adjudicate on that, I'd like to explore with you what would be the consequences if that is how you should read it. Yes, please. Yeah, Jeff.
I don't have the version of the Bible before me that has the wording, but in one of the versions, this phrase, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down upon it, one of the versions has it, I forget what the first one is, but the second part of the sentence has him prowling up and down upon it. And so you, in the first phrase of the sentence, you get a feeling that he has ownership or right to be there. And in the second phrase, it feels like he's an intruder. And I don't know whether that comes out in the original Hebrew, or whether that's just the translators who've added that.
No, but now we have had two excellent comments on textual details that may just be worth, you know, looking a little closer at. So I'd like to return to that in a moment. Let's hear one more comment here.
Present themselves before the Lord. In my recollection, he was not permitted to go back to heaven. In one instance, Sister Hoy mentioned that he called an angel that was coming into the heaven and said, call Jesus, I want to talk to him. And Jesus came out of heaven and talked to him. I think that he's talking to Jesus on this earth, because it contradicts that he was expelled from heaven and not been able to come before the Lord.
So, good. Now, I need to do one little sort of, just to clarify, you know, the terms of the conversation here. Because, yes, it's perfectly fine to bring in, you know, extra Job, text outside of Job. We cannot, you know, help ourselves, we will have to do that. But if we are just doing this conversation on the terms of the book of Job, you know, with the resources given to us by that text, we will not be as easily off the hook as we would be when we sort of, extrapolate and we bring into other things, and Ellen White said this and that, you know. So that's just for now, for the present, think it in terms of the book of Job. So I want to ask this question. Now, if Satan is working for God, you know, if this is a kind of intra-heavenly thing, and God, you know, very proudly and maybe ill-advisedly, God said, you know, have you noticed my servant Job? There is nobody like him, you know. And then Satan, as someone working for God, says, you know, does he fear God for nothing? And then, you know, the consequences, you know, unfold. Now, if that is the case, if that's how the dynamic works here, would that bother you at all, or would that, you know, what would that make you wonder about? Or what sort of consequences might that have if there is essentially a non-adversarial relationship between God and Job? You had a comment first. Let's say I didn't see that.
I'll address what you just said. A couple of things I find problematic is, first, the proximity, his proximity to God. And the way God spoke with him, if an intruder comes into my space, I would say, what are you doing there? I would not say, where do you come from? Like, you were with me before and you went somewhere and you come back. That's two. And also the tone of the back and forth in the is problematic to me as well.
But and that's good. Exactly. So we want to know, you know, what's the body language of this text, and what is the tone of voice? You know, would there be a different tone of voice in one way, or, you know, one scenario, or, you know, versus the other? These are useful things. So let's hear Danielle's question.
Who's the hand here?
Comment, yes.
If you read this as friendly, then where do you account for sin, if that's the appropriate word? Because the fact that they're holding out Job and Satan is justifying Job's behavior as obedience, which suggests there's alternative behavior going on, which is not obedient or fearful or however. So how do you account for that alternative behavior? Satan wouldn't be the source of the alternative behavior if they're friendly and he's working for God then.
I think that's a very good comment, you know, that there is a sort of dualism in the world, you know, good and evil in the world. You know, maybe it's possible to uncouple Satan from that, you know, storyline. But I think that comment is helpful, is useful. So Let me just say one more thing about the scholars, what this means to scholars. So many scholars, maybe most scholars, do not think that Satan is the Satan of New Testament theology. They do think that he is someone working for God. And that he is just, you know, carrying out his God-appointed task. What is one possible consequence of that? Well, David Kleins is the author of, I think he is Australian. I think Bernard Taylor knows him quite well. You can ask him about it. I'm looking at Barry. You know, because I think he has told me that he knows the David Kleins, and I know him too, because he is now a scholar in England, and it works for the Sheffield University and Sheffield, the Press of Sheffield, and they have published my commentary on Romans. So David Kleins has been my contact person for my commentary on Romans, and has been very nice to me, very generous, very, very good. Now, David Kleins has written a three-volume commentary on Job. He knows Hebrew extremely well. The Hebrew of Job is very difficult. You know, textual variants, some words, many words that occur only once in the Hebrew Bible, that's hard to do. You know, the word occurs only once. You know, how do you do it? You know, and you have little to go by. So you have to make assumptions. So translations of the book of Job vary quite a bit because of these ambiguities, you know. But here is David Kleins then. So remember him, Word Biblical Commentary, three volumes. And he has then written a short version of what he thinks about the book of Job. And the title of his article that you can, those of you who have university access, you can go to Atla Religion. And you can put in David Kleins and then his article on under the title Job's Fifth Friend. Job's, how many friends?
Fifth.
Job's
five.
Fifth friend. So three friends, right? You can count. Three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, and four friends, Elihu. And now Job's fifth friend. Who is Job's fifth friend? David Kleins is Job's fifth friend. I'm serious. David Kleins is Job's fifth friend, and he defends Job against the frivolity, the sort of shallowness, the nastiness of the whole plot. Because if Satan is someone who is essentially working for God, and they are sitting there and saying, just, oh, don't fear God for nothing, you know, and Satan, you know, saying this, and then they say, you know, well, let's see, you know, you can do this and that, and don't touch his flesh, and then the second time you do that too. What does David Kleins think about that? He thinks that's frivolous. That is frivolous. And how is it that the whole world, David Kleins says, how is it that the whole world is rhapsodizing about the immense, you know, moral qualities, literary qualities, theological sophistication of the book of Job, when you essentially subject this, you know, ordinary good man to such horrible treatment over that frivolous conversation between God and Hashatan? See what I'm saying, what that could lead to? So in some ways, if you want to rescue the book of Job from that sort of serious theological criticism, you need the second version. You need that this is a serious question. And, you know, this is a serious issue. And they are not on friendly terms. So let's see what we had. We had you saying, repeat what you said on the point that you were making there. On,
well, is he just one of the heavenly beings?
Yes. And Satan also came. The textual element there is Satan also came. Is an insider, as an outsider? There is a suggestion that he might just be an outsider. And then Let's see, if you said going up and you said something about going back and forth,
or the prowling versus blocking
and
better. Ownership versus improvement.
Yeah, the prowling is probably that someone who wishes to sway us in some direction, you know, that this is a problem. But maybe it isn't wrong. Here is what I have done in my chapter on Job, chapter 14. I have actually two chapters in God of Sense and Traditions of Nonsense dealing with Job. And Job is paradigmatic for the point I wish to make. I will make it clearer next Sabbath what I think that point is. But you know, be that as it may, for now, just on the textual issue of going back and forth, the Hebrew language has verb forms that we don't have in English. It has a, you know, the simple forms, like the form for walking. You know, he walks, he walked, you know, he is walking. You can say that in Hebrew, it's very simple. But in Hebrew, but when I want to say in English, he walked back and forth, that's, you know, quite a sentence, isn't it? How many words? He walked back and forth. You know, how many words? Well, five words? He walked back and forth. Aha! In Hebrew, you can do that with one word. In a form of the Hebrew verb called the hispahin. The hispahin, which is a kind of reflexive work. So, hithalak. He walked back and forth. Where have you been? I have walked back and forth. You know, is that someone walking back and forth maliciously, purposelessly, aimlessly, you know, walking back and forth? And you guys are supposed to hear an intra-biblical echo. Let me see who will get this one. You're supposed to hear something there. Adventists should be able to hear it.
Garden of Eden?
Which?
The Garden of Eden?
Eden. Garden of Eden.
Garden of Eden, yes. Yes. What text? Where is there a text Genesis? About walking back and forth using the same Hebrew word, hithalak, you know? And there is a suffix too, you know? So, I mean, you might think this is just okay, you know, this is just hair splitting. But this is detailed work. You do detailed work and you pick up, you know, certain echoes, certain, you know, ideas here that might just help you. So where is the text of walking back and forth? Yes?
No, I have a comment.
Okay, then you don't get to, we want an answer to our question. You were in the Garden of Eden. And you were
walking
back and forth.
As in a circle.
No, you were walking back and forth with Ezekiel 28. You know, that text, Ezekiel 28, verses 19 verses 12 to 19. Ezekiel 28, verses 12 to 19. You were in the Garden of Eden. You were covered by all these wonderful stones. You were the measure of perfection, you know. And you walked back and forth among those stones. Same word. It's used rarely. I'm not saying that this is an absolute proof. But in Ezekiel, the covering cherub walks back and forth as someone who belongs there. And in the book of Job, quite possibly, Where have you been? I have been walking back and forth on the earth with malice, quite possibly. As an outcast, quite likely. See, I think the arguments, if you do subtle, you know, look at nuances, I think the argument for the second version are stronger. You know, the arguments for the adversarial sort of thing. And if it is adversarial, let's go to the question now. What is the question? What is the question? Now we have solved the issue, is it friendly or adversarial? And we are landing on the notion that it is adversarial. Now we need to hear the question. What was the question? Does,
the question in the text.
Yeah.
Where, what is it that says, have you noticed my servant Job? You know, so something might be going on here. Yes, maybe he's bragging. Maybe he is bragging. Maybe, you know, this is some, maybe he doesn't have much to brag about. You know? So he needed this, you know, there he had something, you know, to brag about. So he brags about it. Have you noticed my servant Job? And by the way, if it is friendly, if this is a friendly, you know, Hashatan is a friendly person, you know, why would not he be the one who brings up Job? If he is a sort of fact-finding missionary doing his God-appointed task, why is it God who brings him up? I am saying in my book, I think that it's God brings him up because Job represents evidence that Satan would rather not see. He isn't such a truth seeker after all, in the adversarial way of reading this. You can see what that is saying. So let's hear your comment and then go to our question. You know, God bringing Satan, bringing Job to Satan's attention, and then Satan doing the rejoinder. Yes, please.
The basic question is the suffering of the innocent. Satan presented as an argument against God. So he allowed suffering of the innocent. And I see it as an essential, because the whole universe is witnessing. If there is any excuse, this is the excuse to place it before the whole universe, the suffering of the innocent. And I disagree with your scholar that paints God as doing something completely foolish.
So, I think you've started us in the right way. So let's hear more comments on the issue. What's the question? So let me, just to save time here. So what is the question? Does Job fear God for nothing? Does Job fear God for naught, as he says in the King James Version? So I would like you to unpack that, you know, to lay that out. What do you hear? What is that question all about? I'd like us to focus on that question, because this is in some ways the generative question. Before Job suffers, you know, something is happening behind the scenes.
It's the third time I've got this.
Yeah, okay, sure.
I see this as the underlying question of Satan. Is there any such thing as unselfishness? And he's saying there is no such thing as unselfishness.
He is saying that Job serves God for what he can get. Does Job serve God for nothing? Would you agree with me that the question here is, does unselfishness exist? Would you agree with that? That is a fair way to say it. So where is there a sort of possible lack of selfishness, of unselfishness? Well, on the part of Job, who does not serve God for nothing. You know, he is getting lots out of this relationship. It is very favorable to him. But there is a flip side to it. Let's read those statements by Gustavo Gutierrez. Let's see, how are we doing for time?
We have 20 minutes.
Yeah, but we are going to do the part, another part. I have a second part to this, so we need to do this very quickly now. So would you be willing to read those statements by Gutierrez there? Because I think they help us, and then we can add on to that, and then we can move on to a second point.
Satan does not deny that Job is a devout person. What he questions is rather the disinterestedness of Job's service to God, his lack of concern for a reward. The Satan objects not to Job's works, but to their motivation. Job's behavior, he says, is not for nothing, in Hebrew, and not. In the Satan's view, a religious attitude can be explained only by expectation of a reward. We will shortly learn that this is also the view of Job's friends. If, however, Job be regarded as a truly just man, then, even though there be no other like him in the land, the lie is given to this view of religion.
So that's good. Thank you. The second quotation there is me commenting on Gutierrez and agreeing with him. You know, that he is, that Gutierrez has actually named what is the generative question in Job. Does unselfishness exist? That is a workable thing. Hang on to the microphone. No, hang on to it. Read one more. So read the second one on page 2, of, on the back page, on the back of the page. Yes, Gutierrez, there on the top, the second one there.
The central question of Job is raised at the outset, the role that reward or disinterestedness plays in faith in God and in its consistent implementation. God believes that Job's uprightness is disinterested, and he therefore accepts the challenge. The author is telling us in this way that a utilitarian religion lacks depth and authenticity. In addition, it has something satanic about it.
Oh, if we do this adversarial, we're in a big way. What is lacking in Gutierrez's view? And I'm very much indebted to many scholars here, because there is lots of excellent work done on the Book of Job, and I have benefited a great deal from reading some of it. You know, but what is lacking here seems to me to be, yes, we are finding out that this is a test about whether or not Job is unselfish. Has it in him to have the unselfish, to motivate. What is lacking is, of course, whether God is in on this. You know, is God unselfish? Is God doing whatever God does in a disinterested way? Does God do what God does for nothing? You know, in some, you know, no, not expecting a return on whatever investment God is making. You see that? And now we have, yes, that's here from Harvey. I just told Harvey that I wish I could find something to say where I would feel that I told him, where I were telling him something he doesn't know. It hasn't happened yet. So anyway, let's see.
See, I think the question about Job's selfishness or unselfishness is trivial compared to the question, is God selfish? God wants us to serve him because he's an autocrat.
Didn't I know it?
And that's terrifying as a thought.
But that's the heart of it. Isn't
that's
it?
The heart
that's
of the
heart
issue.
Of it. You know, so on the surface it seems, is Job unselfish or isn't he? You know, is he motivated? Is he in it for the money? You know, for the benefits? Is God in it? Can God not do anything? Can God not, you know, get anything going for God? You know, except by being, you know, in a sort of mercenary relationship with creatures. So I want to hear one more. Did you want to say
I
anything?
Want to comment
yes,
just
please.
A little further. It raises the question of what are the value, what is the value of what God asks of us? Is it simply to pacify God? Or is it in fact the way the universe works? Should we not put sugar in our gas tank and just put gasoline in? Or is somebody just uptight about this?
Good. So one comment more from Danielle, then we will move to our second part of the, what I'd like us to do today.
Job's about Satan's comment, it's also an indictment of himself and of his followers.
So he's so you know, when you see that sure, that's good. That helps us to see, you know, that he is in some ways showing his own hand to some extent, if I understand you correctly. Yes. Good. So let's draw the line here on this question, and let me say it. Try to say it as a, by way of a sort of brief conclusion here. So, we are witness to a conversation between God and Satan, and the relationship is adversarial. Satan is no friend of God, and this question is a pretty nasty question. You know, even if you were, you know, you would be hard pressed to make it a friendly question. You know. You have raised such a fundamental question about the character of the divine government. So, now, is the question in the adversarial sense Is it a trivial question? Would you like to know whether unselfishness exists? Is this going to the heart of the whole sort of foundation for reality and human existence, theology? Does unselfishness exist? Would you like to know?
Does justice exist? Does God reward virtue, or does he punish evil?
Let's not go there. I stood up a hornet's nest. I will never do it again. So, if this question goes to the heart of the matter, we do not need, Job does not need a fifth friend. He needs a better reader of the book of Job. And I say this, in all humility to a David Hines or to Matayatu Tsevat, who was the Bernard Taylor's mentor at the Hebrew Union College, and who I also have read what he says about the morality of the book of Job, and I have explained that in the book. So we are, trying to engage with, significant views here. So let's drop Job for a minute and ask, in our time, in our context, does unselfishness exist? And I would like to read a statement from Reinhold Niebuhr. Jan, would you be willing to be our reader again? So, in my commentary on Romans, in Romans 13, I have a discussion about, there is the context in Romans 12, 13, 14. It's really how to behave. It is really about, how you behave with compassion, how you show love for the neighbor, and so on. And as I was working on that subject, the subject of unselfishness comes up, the selfishness versus unselfishness of the individual, and the selfishness versus the unselfishness of the nation. Because we are not just individuals, we are also citizens. And I'm just a little bit intrigued by the coincidence here, because my daughter, who has worked for a while at the Norwegian Embassy in Cairo, she has also worked on a topic that is quite an important topic now in our corporate world, the notion of corporate social responsibility. How do we behave corporately? How do we behave as nations? And now to the question, not a theological abstract question, but a practical here and now question. Does unselfishness exist? Is it even conceivable? Let's hear what Reinhold Niebuhr says. Reinhold Niebuhr, you've heard of him. He was a German theologian, German ethicist maybe, who came to this country in the 20s or so. He became the most influential public voice for several decades. He was advising presidents. He was the sort of, Billy Graham has been talking to presidents, but Reinhold Niebuhr talked a lot to presidents as a kind of scholar, you might say, the scholarly voice. How many of you have or haven't heard about Reinhold Niebuhr? How many of you have heard or read anything by him? Moral Man and Immoral Society was one of his books. He's sort of fading from view now. But here is something he says that might just be relevant to our topic.
The paradox is that patriotism transmutes individual unselfishness into national egoism. Loyalty to the nation is a high form of altruism when compared to lesser loyalties and more parochial interests. It therefore becomes the vehicle of all the altruistic impulses, and it expresses itself on occasion with such fervor that the critical attitude of the individual toward the nation and its enterprises is almost completely destroyed. The unqualified character of this devotion is the very basis for the nation's power and the freedom to use the power without moral restraint. Thus, the unselfishness of individuals makes for the selfishness of nations. That is why the hope of solving the larger societal problems of mankind merely by extending the social sympathies of individuals is so vain. Altruistic passion is sluiced into the reservoirs of nationalism with great ease and is made to flow beyond them with great difficulty. What lies beyond the nation, the community of mankind, is too vague to inspire devotion.
So, thank you. So let me just, in the time that remains, let's just, first, what is he saying? Number two, do you agree with what he is saying? And if you do, whichever way that goes, what to do about it? So first, what is he saying? So here is the individual, and here is the nation. And the individual in this example is unselfish, right?
Yes.
But to the extent that he talks about the individual, he talks about the individual as an unselfish, you know, that it is possible that you can conceive of the individual being unselfish. And then what does he say more? That the unselfish individual within the constellation that we are talking about here, the individual, the unselfishness of the individual for the nation, does what? Makes the nation more selfish or less selfish? Okay, so what he is saying then
selfish.
Is that
selfish.
Unselfishness of the individual enables, is in some ways the enabler, the grand enabler of selfish conduct on behalf of the nation, you know, by the nation. Do you agree with that? He is saying that? You agree that? So he is saying that. You agree with that idea? Is it true? Now, we know that that's what he's saying. Is it true? It's true? You think it's true? I think it's true, too, by the way. Just to make sure we don't get any discussion about that subject. That far. By all means, you know, you can disagree. But here, so in some ways, the unselfishness of the citizen is inversely proportional to the selfishness of the nation. Or maybe that's not how to say it. I mean, individual unselfishness, you're willing to sacrifice yourself for the nation, makes it possible for the nation to be, you know, selfish. So let's read again the second one, the second line, just one more line there. How much time do we have left now?
4 minutes.
4 minutes. 4 minutes.
Three.
The most significant moral characteristic of a nation is its hypocrisy.
Do you agree with that? That nations use a lot of, use all kinds of rhetorical things. Don't believe it, because it isn't, true. Yes.
The individual cannot be unselfish as a part of the nation if that produces selfishness. So there's individual dishonesty in the idea that you can be unselfish and a part of the whole.
Okay, now we're talking. Now let's see where that takes us, if that is true. So what does that mean? Well, it means that the individual, to some extent, becomes responsible for the conduct of the
nation.
That's right. The individual becomes responsible for the conduct of the nations too, because we are sort of tied together in what John Silver, as a Kant scholar of Immanuel Kant, he says we are tied together in what he calls a matrix of responsibility. Matrix of responsibility. Our individual conduct is in some ways tied to other things. So what then, what are we to do with that? Let's read, and I'm sorry, I know that there are more comments here. I would like to do more comments. We'll have to talk
talk to one-on-one afterwards, anyone who wants to do that. But let's read this last statement by Niebuhr.
Since the class character of national governments is a primary, though not the only cause of their greed, present international anarchy may continue until the fear of catastrophe amends or catastrophe itself destroys the present social system and builds more cooperative national societies. There may not be enough intelligence in modern society to prevent catastrophe.
I thought you would like to have that thought with you for Christmas. instead of reading, you know, from the Gospel of Luke tonight, why don't you read these things by Niebuhr, you know, and ending, you know, you look around your circle of family and friends, and you look around and you read a sentence, there may not be enough intelligence in modern society to prevent catastrophe, you know, and then you say, as they say in the movie, what is it, how that movie goes? It's a play on Walter Cronkite. Good night and good luck. I am deadly serious about this. It seems to me we have escaped altogether too easily from the sort of consequences. Yes, does unselfishness exist? It does exist in God, in Job. Does unselfishness in some ways also, if it does exist, translate into altruistic conduct in the family of nations? Or does unselfishness stop at the ocean's edge, you know, at the shoreline or at the border? That my conduct, even though the conduct of myself and the conduct of my nation affects the people in Bangladesh because the water levels are rising, you know, and my conduct and the conduct of my nation affects, you know, the world community in so many ways. So, you know, and I say this now very sort of, you know, I say it tongue in cheek. I don't mean it. I just say it tongue in cheek. Can you accomplish what needs to be accomplished within a paradigm of making America great again? And now that is unsaid. Your turn.
Time's up.
I have books here, and you can read everything about this stuff in my
Santa place. Claus will be getting a gift. We also have envelopes here to give to the Roy Branson Legacy Sabbath School class. And you'll be here next Sabbath.
Next time God will be here, I speak from the whirlwind.
Okay, great. Let's give our benediction. You have it before you there. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
Merry Christmas, everybody.